Yo, Adam Saxon with Guy in the Cube, and in this video, I want to open your mind to the possibilities of automation and scripting using the new Microsoft Fabric command line interface. This was announced at public preview at Microsoft Build, and I want to show you how to install it, how to use it. So enough of all this talking, you know what we like to do here on Guy in the Cube. Let's do what? Let's head over to my machine. I'll have a link in the description to where you can go find more about the Fabric command line interface, but let's get going. So I went ahead and installed Python, and what you can do now is from the command prompt, once Python's installed, I can just do pip install msfabric CLI. And once that's done, then we can go ahead and actually log into it. The executable for this is called fab or FAB. And so the first command we'll do is we'll want to log in. So we'll do fab auth login, and it's going to ask me if I want to do interactive, or I can do this from a service principal or a managed identity. For this demonstration, I'm just going to do the interactive login so we can kind of show you how this works. But if you want to learn more, go check out the docs descriptions down below. All right, I'm just going to hit enter and boom, we are there. One thing you'll notice is that my command line didn't change, the command line prompt. And so if I want to issue another command, for each command, I have to do fab as part of it. What you can do is you can change the mode. By default, it's set to command line so that you issue it every time. But in this case, we can go ahead and change the config mode to what's referred to as interactive. So it'll basically launch into a shell, which then you can just issue more commands. So let's do that. And then we'll do the fab auth login again. Do interactive, and now you'll notice the prompt changed. This is because now I'm inside of the Fabric command line interface, and so now I can issue multiple commands inside of the same instance without issuing fab in front of it. Either way works, it's up to you. So now let's do this. I've got an actual workspace here. Let's go to Contoso warehouse parts, and you'll see I've got a lake house and I've got this pipeline to ingest some data, which basically just puts it inside of the lake house. So let's see how this looks like from the command line interface. So we're going to change directory to that workspace. You can issue ls or you can do dir. So either one works. So if I do ls, same thing. Just question if you want more of the DOS format or you want more of a Linux format. So now we can see the list of items in that workspace. That's great. So now let's go back out and we're going to make a new workspace. It's going to be called new project 5. Go and hit enter, and it's going to yell at me because I didn't specify the capacity that's going to be used for this. So now off the top of your head, you may not know what the capacity name is, but we need to get the capacity name so that we can issue the actual command using that capacity. So let's do a list off of the capacities themselves. So those are all our capacities. We're going to pick capacity West US. So let's go ahead and do that. So we're just issuing a parameter on that same make directory. Once the workspace is created, we'll go ahead and list what's actually in the workspace itself. And we'll see that there's nothing in there. And that's good because it should be empty. So now that I've got the new workspace created, what I want to do is I want to copy that pipeline from the Contoso warehouse parts workspace into this new workspace. How would you do that normally? Maybe you'd recreate it manually. Maybe you'd use like Git integration to just move it over. You know, there's a lot of different options, but with the command line interface, this makes it easy. Check this out. So I'm going to use the copy command, which is CP, and we're going to say we're going to move the ingest data pipeline from the Contoso warehouse parts workspace into the new project 5 workspace, and we're going to call it the same name. You could call it a different name if you want. All right, that completed. So now let's go back into that workspace. We're going to list what's there. We can now see that the pipeline's there. Now check this out. I want to see what's in that workspace. So let's do open. And it's going to open it in a new tab, and bam, we can see our actual workspace there. This is pretty crazy, right? So I'm using the command line to actually interact with Fabric. It's very cool. So if we go into that, we'll see that we've got a parameter listed for the pipeline called lakehouse ID. And if I click on the copy data, we go to destination. We're using parameters as part of this and environment variables to actually be able to automate some of this. So we're actually saying use the parameter ID for the lakehouse ID. Of note, this has to be the GUID, not the name. And then for the workspace ID, there is this default item here that a system variable that lets you choose the actual workspace ID. And when you do that, it chooses this data factory pipeline item. So we'll go ahead and leave that the way it is. So pipeline data factory, that's good. So let's go back to our workspace. And now what we're going to do is we're going to create a new lake house. So watch this. So we're saying create the lake house as part of it. You'll see it showing up in the browser. That's amazing. And then if we do an ls-l, we're going to list the items there along with their actual IDs. And so we can see our lake house there at the bottom, which is amazing. So now what? My lake house is empty. I need data. So let's go ahead and run the pipeline to get the data into the lake house. This is crazy. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start the actual pipeline job, issuing a command, and I'm going to grab the GUID of the new lake house that we created and put that in as the parameter, and let's go ahead and run it. And one thing we can do here is it says you can run this command to see what the status of the job is. So let's go and run that. And we can see here that it says in progress. I know it's a little squished, but you can see that there. And obviously your pipelines are going to take however long they're going to take to run, depending on what kind of data that you're in, but you can keep running this status job. You could even script that out and automate it, right? And parse out the details of it to know, is it still in progress? Is it completed? Did it fail? And then do something from a code perspective outside of that. This is great, right? We're getting there. All right, let's run status again. And we can see now that it shows completed. So the data should be there in the actual lake house itself. And so let's go into the lake house. And when we go into the products table, we can see our data's here. So the pipeline actually ran, but let's take this a step further. So let's go into the lake house itself, lh1.lakehouse, and then we'll do a list of the tables. And we can see that we have one table there called products, which matches with what's inside the lake house. Then what we can do is say, list out the schema for the products table, and boom, there's our schema for the actual table itself. That was bananas, right? So we started with just a workspace inside of Microsoft Fabric. We installed the command line interface. Then we went through, we created a new workspace. We copied the pipeline over. We created a new lake house. We executed the pipeline job to get the data in the lake house. And then we could explore the lake house from the command line prompt. Hopefully this gives you an idea of the possibilities of what you can do with this command line interface. The team's going to keep working on this as new APIs come out. I actually worked with a customer. They were doing the old classic PowerShell stuff. And now when they started looking at this for doing maintenance and updating items and copying things, they were blown away. So I definitely recommend you take a look at this to see how it can help you from an automation perspective or just exploring things if you just like being in a command line. I'd love to hear your feedback. Have you tried the command line interface? Let me know down in the comments below. You know, is there something missing? Maybe you want to see something more. Let us know. As always, from Patrick, Martha, and myself, thank you so much for watching. Keep being awesome, and we'll see you in the next video.